to walk humbly with your God.
As we now understand what is perhaps the most profound meaning of the painting, one cannot look at the feet of the younger son without wondering about his journey, not merely the journey home, but all the wandering and squandering that have characterized his misspent youth. These are the feet of one who has suffered much on life's pilgrimage. It is not too difficult to imagine some of the hardships of the journey and to travel on the same road with him. These are the feet his mother tickled when she washed him, the feet played happily on his father's arms, chasing playmates and dreams. They rode away richly shod when, as a young man, he was bent on seeing the world, and now they return torn and bleeding, trudging wearily towards the familiar landscape of his childhood home. Rembrandt has created a strange harmony between the rags that the young man wears and his bare feet. We can feel the sensitivity of the artist, above all, in his portrayal of the feet and hands in this picture, the bent posture of one who has been quite literally brought to his knees. I have carved you on the palm of my hands. The father reaching out loving hands to his son reveals what is probably one of the most astonishing features in any Western painting. The hands that draw him close are not a pair. They represent all that can be uttered about human existence, and at the same time they plumb profound depths about the truth of our God. They lie on the shoulders of the son like the light yoke that Jesus describes as his own. They are both male and female at the same time. The hand on our right, the father's left hand, is a masculine hand and the hand of a labourer, perhaps the God who created all and holds everything in being. The right hand is a feminine hand and may represent the mothering and nurturing of a God who brings us to birth and touches our hearts with tenderness. They remind us of the works of the letter to the Ephesians as they try to describe God. And then you will have strength to grasp the breadth and length, the height and depth, so that you may be filled with the utter fullness of God. You may wish to dwell in prayer on the different qualities that these hands represent. One is sinewy and work-torn, with dirty broken nails and a muscular wrist and thumb. The other is more delicate, with long sensitive fingers, a narrow wrist, and well-manicured nails. Masculine-feminine is not the only interpretation. First Third World may also bring to mind some nations' struggle for dignity and justice. Beyond, in the darkness that encloses the intimate moment of the father's embrace, Rembrandt has traced the figures of two women hovering at the edge of the scene. They gravitate towards the light that the artist has created to symbolise the great light of God's presence. One is at an upper window and she appears to be looking down on the scene. The other woman is closer. She hovers in the background, leaning against a pillar or arch that echoes the postures of the father's gently bending form. In this woman, we may wish to imagine the mother of the prodigal son standing in awe at the return of her lost child. She speaks to us of the intimacy of ordinary life, the daily tasks faithfully continued despite the grief, then interrupted by a momentous arrival. She too has waited many years for her son's return, but she does not break into heart-stirring moment at the father's embrace. Like the Spirit of God, she waits for the appropriate moment to enter the scene as she hovers in the shadows. We struggle to find images of God, but one image that Jesus himself uses is that of a woman who, having lost a coin, sweeps the house until she finds it. He compares it to the kingdom or reign of God who seeks the lost. Elsewhere, he compares the kingdom to a baker woman who takes some yeast, mixes it with flour, and leavens her dough until all of it is raised, ready for the oven. What homely passages these are. Jesus also longs to gather the city of Jerusalem about him, as a mother hen gathers her chicks. By Jerusalem we understand all those he wishes to save. His own people and the nations of the world, creating Jerusalem anew in the Spirit. So Jesus presents us with these images of a loving parenting God who can be described as father and mother to us. In the Hebrew Testament, there is a body of literature known as the wisdom literature. It parallels other traditions in scriptures like the prophets, and it gives us unique insights into the being of God. Jesus would have prayed and studied in this tradition, which recognizes those particular mothering qualities we find in God. For example, he would have prayed the words of the psalmist, "Like a weaned child on its mother's breast, even so is my soul." When he prayed these words, perhaps he brought to mind the times he spent in Mary's arms when he was a small child.
I will come to you in the silence. I will lift you from all your fear. You will hear my voice. I claim you as my choice. Be still and know I am here. For all who are hopeless, I am light for all who long to see. In the shadows of the night, I will be your light. Come and rest in me. Do not be afraid, I am with you. I have called you his by name. Come and follow me, I will bring you